Okay, so let's start with what I want you to do for next time this morning. Right, so I've got it all up here on the board. There are three poems I want you to read. I want you to read Aunt Jennifer's Tigers by Adrienne Rich, London by William Blake, and Stop All the Clocks, Cut Off the Telephone by W.H. Auden. And what I want you to pay attention to as you're reading is the kind of mood that is evoked in each poem. Like, what does the emotional tone of each of these poems seem to be, right? Is it humorous? Is it distressed? Is it angry? Is it melancholy, right? Whatever you can get about the emotional tenor of the poem. And I also want you thinking about how rhyme and meter contribute to it. And a lot of the, that is how they contribute to that mood that you detect, right? That emotional tone. And we'll talk a little bit about how rhyme and meter work today and how they can affect meaning in language. So that's what I want you to read for next time, for Thursday. For Friday, we talked a little bit about this last time, but here are the more explicit directions, right? I want you to write a haiku. So a haiku is a fairly simple Japanese poem that is concentrated on a single image, right? The form is very, very simple, right? Three lines, first line, five syllables, second line, seven syllables, third line, five syllables. No rhyme. And what I want you to try to write about, I want you to take an image from nature, right? Something you have observed in nature. And I want you to write about that. Okay, so does anybody have any questions about the readings for next time or about the poem that I want you to write? And just to remind everybody how the creative writing is going to work, right? You'll upload it to a folder in GeorgiaView. You will get a point just for doing it. Right? You'll do five of these. It's worth 5% of your grade. If you just do the poem, you get 1 point, right? You do all five, you get all 5 points. I will then compile them into a document that I will send to the whole class with your names taken off. And you will read them and decide which one you think is the best. And whoever's poem gets the most votes gets 2 extra points added to his or her final average, right? So not only is this worth doing for you, just for the sake of the points, right? It is worth your while to try to do as well as you can. I will be putting a decoy poem in there as well that I wrote. And if you choose my poem, then I get to decide who gets the 2 points, right? Otherwise, it's votes. So any questions about any of that? No? Yeah, okay. Ciao.
About haiku, do you mean the 5 syllables or 5 words?
Syllables. Yeah, so everybody, I have learned in recent years that not everybody's elementary school education focused on the same things mine did. So does everybody know what we mean by a syllable? Okay, it's like just the basic units of sound in a word, right? So if I were to break up the word, right? Little, right? Lit is 1 syllable. You say it a little louder, so that's the stressed syllable. Toll is the other syllable. Okay, any other questions about this? All right, then I look forward to reading what you come up with. Does anybody have any questions about the paper that's due tonight?
Oh yeah, will it be part of our midterm grade?
Yes, it will be part of your midterm grade. It'll be the biggest part of your midterm grade, actually, thus far. Anything else?
And yeah.
Pardon?
When will that be free?
Well, I should have them done by tomorrow night.
With the half a letter bump. pretend interaction center be added as well?
That will be added, yep. Yep, those of you who went to the writing center will get those extra points. And just make sure that it's uploaded to the Paper One folder by 11:59 tonight. Anything else? Has everybody got all this information down? Can I erase this now? Okay, not quite. All right, well, what I'd like to talk about today, right, last time we discussed the speaker in the poem, right, trying to discern the nature of the speaker, the character of the speaker, based on clues that he or she gives you in the poem, right? And we discussed the speaker as a kind of invented character, right? Always an invented persona for the poet, never to be taken necessarily as the poet himself or herself. So today, what I want to talk about is the poetic equivalent of setting, right? So while speaker is the equivalent of a narrator in a poem, we call the equivalent of the setting in a poem situation. Now, in a short story or a novel, right, in a work of fiction, when we talk about the setting, we are generally talking about more than physical location, right? Physical location is part of it. But we also need to think about the historical era in which it's set, and even things like time of day, right? So what the setting does for a short story is give us a kind of context for the action, right? And the situation in a poem does pretty much the same thing, right? The situation is the context for whatever is happening in the poem. And it does involve all the same sorts of things that setting does in a short story, right? So yes, physical location matters to the extent that we can actually discern it. Historical period matters, time of day matters, but we also need to think about right, who's there, right? Is there anyone there with the speaker? And what prompts the speaker to start talking? Right, what is the stimulus that gets the speaker to start this poetic outpouring? So let's start actually because it's a little more contemporary, the language might be a little easier to follow. Let's start with the Martina Spada poem, Litany at the Tomb of Frederick Douglass. If you have the green edition like I do, it is on page 532. 768 in the red book. Thank you, Wimbrick. So what we have here is an example of what's called an occasional poem. And an occasional poem is written to commemorate a specific event or or moment in time. Right, so you write an occasional poem to celebrate or to comment on some event, some occasion. So the head note here to Espada's poem, right, he gives us the location, Mount Hope Cemetery, Rochester, New York, November 7th, 2008. So what's the occasion for writing this poem? What's just happened that he's...
The election of President Obama.
Yeah. It's just after Election Day in 2008. And the United States has elected its first black president. So the event matters, right? The event is what prompts the poem, but the poem is really more about where he is than it is about the event. Where is he specifically located here?
Frederick Douglass's grave.
Yeah, he's at the grave of Frederick Douglass, who is doing great work and getting more and more attention these days despite having been dead for 120 years. Right. So, who's Frederick Douglass? What do you guys know about Frederick Douglass?
Abolitionist.
Yes, prominent abolitionist. Good. What else do you know about Frederick Douglass? Do you know anything else about Frederick Douglass? Yeah. The most famous episode from his autobiography, right, the one that I'm sure a lot of us had to read in grade school or high school, is the one in which he teaches himself how to read, right? And why was it a big deal that Douglass taught himself how to read? Apart from the fact that it is, in fact, very difficult to teach yourself how to read.
Because slaves had no education or anything at that time. They didn't have anybody to teach them.
Yep, he was born a slave. It was illegal to teach a slave how to read, right? Slaves were not permitted to learn how to read. So Douglass didn't just teach himself how to read. Now, if you read this portion of his autobiography, he has a purpose in mind in teaching himself how to read. He wants to be able to forge a pass so that he can get out of Maryland, the slave state in which he lived, up into the free state of Pennsylvania. But in doing so, he reads a lot of oratory textbooks, right? He reads a lot of classical speeches and learns philosophy and eloquence along the way, right? So while he's working towards this very, very narrow purpose, he's also learning philosophy, he's learning rhetoric. And so when he does escape to the free states, he becomes, on the one hand, a noted orator, right? Becomes an in-demand speaker who has speaking engagements not only all over the U.S., or at least in places where he would be allowed to speak, but also in Europe, right? He becomes a celebrity. And he also becomes a newspaper publisher. In fact, this is how he primarily makes his living, right, as a newspaper publisher in the Northeast. So, with this context in mind, right, let's look at the poem and what Espada is doing with this particular location and the occasion, right? Can I get a volunteer to read this? Anybody?
Mm-hmm.
poem?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. This is the longitude and latitude of the impossible.
Mm-hmm.
This is the epicenter of the unthinkable. This is the crossroads of the unimaginable. The tomb of Frederick Douglass, 3 days after the election. This is a world spinning away from the gravities of centuries. But the grave of a fugitive slave has become an altar. This is the tomb of a man born as, what is this, a tale?
Chattel.
Oh, chattel. Who taught himself to read in secret.
Slow down a little.
Sorry.
It's okay.
Scraping the letters in his name with chalk on wood. Now on the anvil flat stone. A campaign button fills the O in Douglas. The button says, Obama. This is the tomb of a man in chains who left his fingerprints on the slave breaker's throat so the whip would never carve his back again. Now, a labor union t-shirt drapes itself across the stone, offered up by a nurse, a janitor, a bus driver. A sticker on the sleeve said, I voted today. This is the tomb of a man who rolled his cause to arms off the press, peering through spectacles at the abolitionist headline, now a newspaper, spreads above his date of birth and death. The headline says, Obama wins. This is the stillness at the heart of the storm that began in the body of the first slave, dragged aboard the first ship to America. Yellow leaves descend in waves, and the newspaper flutters on the tomb like the sails. Douglass saw it in the bay, like the eyes of a slave closing to watch himself. Escape with the tide. Believers and spirits will see the pages trembling on the stone and say, look how the slave boy teaches himself to read. I say a prayer, the first in years, that here we bury what we call the impossible, the unthinkable, the unimaginable, now and forever. Amen.
All right. Thank you. All right, so what does this location seem to mean for the poet? Or for the speaker, anyway, in the poem?
A location, I'm in an area of like, not opportunity, but like an area where I guess history.
Okay.
Is
pardon?
Yeah. Stay grateful.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. What would be your evidence of? I think. Yeah. We'll get to the history thing in a moment here. Yeah. Why would you say he's grateful? What makes the tone of this sound grateful to you?
Because he keeps saying the impossible happened, the unthinkable happened, mm-hmm. and the unimaginable happened.
Yeah, and he associates the impossible, the unthinkable, and the unimaginable. With this particular spot, right? And with map coordinates. Right, latitude and longitude, epicenter, crossroads. Do we see a progression here in this repetition in this first little verse paragraph? Right, this is the longitude and latitude of the impossible. This is the epicenter of the unthinkable. This is the crossroads of the unimaginable. What's latitude and longitude mean? What do these refer to? Yeah, coordinates, right? They're lines that are laid on a map, right, on a globe, to show you sort of either how far north or south you are or how far east or west you are, right? And these are all over the map, right? You can know your specific latitude and longitude. But yeah, latitude and longitude stretch across the globe, right? What about the epicenter? What's an epicenter?
Is that the center of something, right?
Is it the focus? Like?
Yeah, it's the focus, the focal point, right? Right, so, okay, we've located our coordinates on the map. We've got our focal point, and then what does this focal point turn into? We move from epicenter to what?
Crossroads.
To Crossroads, yeah. This is where paths meet. Right, this is sort of what we call a kind of like liminal or in-between spot, right? This crossroads, right? This is where all roads come together. All the roads of the impossible, the unthinkable, the thinkable, the unimaginable, and go off in a variety of different directions. So we move from these images of sort of locating where we are to locating places where we can go from here, right? This isn't just a focal point, it's also a potential exit, or a series of potential exits. Now, you were saying a moment ago about history, Shiking. How does history come into the poem?
Because it keeps referring to like Obama being elected and, mm-hmm. and how, well, that's pretty much what I said, because it keeps referring to Obama being elected. And,
right.
And relative to, I guess, Frederick Douglass and his tomb. So I just kind of, I guess I was thinking it was historic, because it's two story situations.
Right. We've got this event in the recent past, right? This 2008 event. And whenever he talks about something related to the 2002 Obama's election, is he talking about it in isolation, or is he talking about something else alongside it? Right. This is the tomb of a man born as chattel, who taught himself to read in secret, scraping the letters in his name with chalk on wood. Now on the anvil flat stone, a campaign button fills the O in Douglas. The button says Obama.
Past to present.
Yeah, there's this comparison between past and present in the second part of the poem, right?
Everything is like, that has anything to do with Obama is in reference to Frederick Douglass.
Yeah. Douglass had to scrape his own name on a plank of wood, right? The hard work that he did learning to write his own name has been done for Obama, right? Who now can sort of pass out campaign buttons with his name on them. This is the tomb of a man in chains who left his fingerprints on the slave breaker's throat so the whip would never carve his back again. Now a labor union t-shirt drapes itself across the stone, offered up by a nurse, a janitor, a bus driver. A sticker on the sleeve says, "I voted today." Right? This represents a transition from forced slave labor, right, to voluntary labor with rights and benefits, right? Slave to union member with the right to vote. This is the tomb of a man who rolled his call to arms off the press, peering through spectacles at the abolitionist headline. Now a newspaper spreads above his dates of birth and death. The headline says, "Obama wins." So Douglass's newspaper, arguing for the abolition of slavery, is then juxtaposed against a contemporary newspaper which declares an African-American man the winner of the presidential contest, right? So all of this hard work that Douglass did in his lifetime, right? That's the first image. And the second image is the eventual payoff from that, right, over a century later. This is the stillness at the heart of the storm that began in the body of the first slave, dragged aboard the first ship to America. Yellow leaves descend in waves, and the newspaper flutters on the tomb, like the sails Douglas saw in the bay, like the eyes of a slave closing to watch himself escape with the tide. Believers and spirits would see the pages trembling on the stone and say, "Look how the slave boy teaches himself to read." I say a prayer the first in years, that here we bury what we call the impossible, the unthinkable, the unimaginable, now and forever. Amen. Why do you think there's so much focus in the poem on literacy and on reading? Yeah, Winbrick.
Maybe because, like, African Americans getting the ability to read, like, in a widespread context, that's, like, that's the only thing that's going to elevate them to, like, a higher status in, like, different chance.
Well, and this was step one, right?
Yeah.
Learning to read was step one for Douglas. Learning to read was step one on his path to freedom. And once he knows how to read, he can write, he can publish, he can spread information to others who can then learn to read, right? Right, these ships in the bay, right, these have contact with other parts of the world, with other parts of the country. Right, these ideas can spread. So the slave boy teaches himself to read, and his descendants generations later reap the benefits of his efforts once again. So what I really wanted you to get from this is how the poem is tied to, like, how an occasional poem like this is tied to a specific moment in time and to a specific setting, right? It matters when the poet is speaking, right, 3 days after the 2008 election, and it matters where he is speaking, at the tomb of a person whom the poet argues made this possible. So, let's move from this to the John Donne poem, to the Flea. It's in 527 in the green book. If you have the red one, it is on some other page.
Pardon?
It's on 764 in the red one. So this one, I imagine you're probably going to find a little bit more difficult and confusing, in part because the language is a little bit more archaic. It's a 17th century poem, and also because the metaphor at the center of it is kind of weird. How many of you have seen this poem before? Any of you read The Flea before? Read John Donne before? I'll take your generalized silence to mean no. Okay. So, can I get a volunteer to read the first stanza for us, please? Someone who has not read yet. Let's spread this around a little bit. Yeah, Joanne, go for it.
Mark for his flea, and Mark is a little that wounds them, and I is me. Suck me first, and I suck thee. And this flea are two bloods men would be. Thou knowest that this cannot be said, a sin, nor shame, nor loss of maiden head. Yet this endures before it wounds, and can persuade for one blood made of two. And this, alas, is more than we would do.
All right, great. Thank you, Juwan. Okay, so how many people are involved in this poem?
Two
people. And who are they? How do they seem to be related to one another?
Are they married?
No, so they're not married.
He only seems to be relating, like, through the blood of the flea.
Yeah, the direct relation there is between the flea that has sucked blood from him and from her, right?
And I read, like, a little footnote on the bottom of the page. It says that, like, back then it was thought to be kinship, I guess. Like, you're related to them after causing the blood.
Well, not really kinship. That's not really the metaphor he's going for here. The way people used to believe a child was conceived was through the mingling of the blood of the parents, right? Back, you know, before we had microscopes and could actually see sperm and eggs, right? People didn't know those things existed. So they believed that it was a mingling of the blood that actually led to conception. So, what's going on inside the flea, right? The flea has bitten him, it's bitten her. So as far as the speaker is concerned, what have they already done? Pardon? I'm sorry, I couldn't hear it. Yeah, what he's trying to do is convince her to have sex with him, right? And he says, hey, this flea bit me, it bit you, our bloods already mingle within the flea, right? You lose no honor from this, right? This did not cost you virginity, right? So, just listen, right? Mark the flea. The flea is a metaphor, at least in the first stanza, for sex. So what we have here is a man trying to convince a woman to sleep with him. Mark, well, mark but this flea, and mark in this how little that which thou deniest me is, right? This tiny, insignificant little thing like a flea. It sucked me first, and now sucks thee, and in this flea our two bloods mingled be. Thou knowest that this cannot be said a sin, nor shame, nor loss of maidenhead, yet this enjoys before it woo, and pampered swells with one blood made of two, and this, alas, is more than we would do. So, he wants to have sex, she is denying him, and he is trying to explain to her why it's no big deal, right? Why this is not something she should be concerned about, not something she should worry about. Now, if we move to the second stanza, can I get a volunteer to read the second stanza? So with, oh, stay three lives. Anybody? All you have to do is read words.
Oh, stay, three lives and one free spare. Where we almost, yeah, more than married are. Yeah, more than married are.
Mm-hmm.
This flea is you and I, and this, our marriage bed, and our marriage temple is. I didn't understand. Is it more?
Yeah, there's more.
Oh.
Keep going.
Those parents brothers, and you, we're met, and cloistered in these living walls of jet. Though yous make you apt to kill me, let not to that self-murder added be. And sacrilege three sins and killing three.
Okay, so what is the woman apparently about to do?
Mary?
No. He's switching the metaphor up a little bit here, right? The flea becomes not just a metaphor for sex anymore, right? The flea becomes a metaphor for marriage. Right? We are married within this little flea. Even if not in the conventional sense. But what is she about to do? Why does he say, oh stay, three lives and one flea spare?
About to die.
No. Who or what is about to die?
She is, or he is, or she is about to die.
Not well.
Murder or
something? Well, what's she gonna kill?
The flea.
Yeah, she's threatening to kill the flea. She's like, oh yeah, right? You think this flea is a metaphor for our relationship? Well, I'll show you. He's like, no, wait, hey, slow down. Don't kill that flea. Right? We are married within the walls of that flea, right? As our bloods mingle inside of it, right? You won't let me have what I want. Your parents will not let us be together. But we can at least join together within the little flea, right? This is our marriage temple, our marriage bed. And then in the third stanza, can I get somebody to read from Cruel and Sudden? Yeah, Gabriel, go for it.
Cruel and Sudden, hast thou since refooled thy nail in blood of innocence.
Mm-hmm.
Wherein could this flea guilty be, except in that drop which is sucked from thee? Yet thou chunk shining, and sayest that thou findest not thyself nor me the weaker now. 'Tis true, then learn how false fears be, just so much honor when thou used to me. What ways that displeased death to fight me?
Alright, thank you. So, now what has she gone and done? She killed the flea, right? She's purpled her nail in blood of innocence, right? She's killed the flea and the life that was building within the flea and his beautiful little metaphor. Right? She's just gone and crushed it. Wherein could this flea guilty be, except in that drop which it sucked from thee? Yet thou triumphst and sayst that thou finds not thyself nor me the weaker now, right? So whatever was going on inside the flea, right? She's no weaker or sicker. He's no weaker and sicker, right? She says, everything's fine. I don't feel any different. So then how does he turn this back around? What does the flea become a metaphor for yet again? 'Tis true, then learn how false fears be. Just so much honor, when thou yield'st to me, will waste, as this flea's death took life from thee. Is the flea still a metaphor for marriage in the third stanza? What's it a metaphor for again?
Say again, so it's a metaphor for sex.
Yeah. This guy is remarkably persistent, right?
How do you get that from that, though? Like, what part of that suggests he's still talking about sex?
'Tis true, then learn how false fears be, right? Mm-hmm. Everything you're afraid of clearly is trivial. Just so much honor, when thou yields to me, will waste, as this flea's death took life from thee, right? So you're worried about your honor, your reputation, your virginity, right? You'll lose as much when you yield to me as you did when you crushed that little flea, right? So, our slimy speaker, right? Whatever she does, tries to turn this metaphor to his own advantage, right? The flea always means for him whatever it's most convenient for it to mean. Whatever he thinks is most going to advance his argument. Right? In the first stanza, it's a connection between the two of them, right? In the second stanza, it's a true and spiritual marriage. And in the third stanza, it's just a little trivial thing, just like the thing that he wants from her. As he sees it, right? So this would also probably be a pretty good place to start talking about rhyme and meter and how these function in poetry. Since it is a very, very kind of regular sort of poem, right? It's very structured. So let's talk first about rhyme, since that's a little bit easier. What's the rhyme scheme in this poem? We've got three stanzas. Do they all seem to have the same rhyme scheme?
Yeah.
Okay, what is that rhyme scheme?
A, B, B, C, C.
Okay.
B, B, B.
OK. Okay, so we have three pairs of rhymes, right? Does anybody know what we call these kinds of paired rhymes?
Couplets.
Yeah, good, these are couplets. And when you have three rhymes together in a row, we call this a tercet. So the rhyme scheme is three couplets and a tercet. Now, how many stanzas do we have in the poem?
Three.
And how many figures, characters do we have in the poem? Include the flea.
Three,
right? So one thing that we note from observing the rhyme scheme and the stanza pattern is that just about everything in the poem works in threes, right? Three couplets and a tercet in each stanza. Three stanzas, three characters. Three separate arguments from the speaker to his mistress. So, one thing you might want to consider as you look at the poem, right, is what is going on with all of the threes, right? This is one of the sorts of things that paying at least cursory attention to the rhyme scheme can clue you into. Now, I think it's significant as well that the first six lines of each stanza are couplets, right? I mean, after all, what is the poem ultimately about?
Clue being together.
Yeah, it's about a form of coupling, right? So the form will often reflect the content of the poem in some way, right? This concerns a couple coming together, and so the rhyme scheme is built mostly of couplets, and when the two come together, it makes three, right? Hence the tercet at the end of each stanza. Now, you can dig into rhyme a little bit more specifically as well to pull more details out of a poem. So the two main types of rhyme, true rhyme anyway, that we want to talk about are masculine and feminine rhyme. A masculine rhyme is a rhyme that ends on a single stressed syllable. So, you know, if you're rhyming man and pan, or one, gun, right? Now, usually when you see a masculine rhyme at the end of a line, what this is doing is kind of stopping that line dead in its tracks, right? It's a kind of forceful way to end a line that prevents the idea from flowing over into the next line. Feminine rhyme ends on a much more open note, right? Two syllables, first syllable stressed, second syllable unstressed. So, for example, if you were to rhyme little and spittle. Right. This ends the line on a kind of descending note, right? It relieves tension in the line. It makes it easier for the idea at the end of the line to flow into the next line. It doesn't close down the idea in quite the same way that masculine rhyme does. Now, sometimes these are also used to indicate certain characteristics of the speakers. So if we look through this particular poem, if we look at the rhymes, let's say in the first stanza, this is the be said
maidenhead
woo to do. Are these masculine or feminine rhymes?
Masculine.
Yeah, these are all masculine rhymes, right? Which is appropriate to the content of the poem, right? After all, I mean, what is the situation here? We've got a male speaker trying to bend a female listener to his will. And so the lines all end on these forceful masculine rhymes. Now, it's actually really hard to rhyme in English. There are relatively few true rhymes in the English language. So a lot of poets, if they're working in an otherwise relatively regular rhyme scheme, will resort to what's called slant rhyme. And there are three basic kinds of slant rhyme. The first is called consonance. In a consonance rhyme, the consonant sounds at the beginning and the end of the word are the same, right? So the outer shell of the word is the same. For example, in the poem The Wild Swans at Cool by William Butler Yeats, he rhymes the word swan with the word stone, right? They don't actually rhyme with each other, but they share those consonant sounds. What a consonance rhyme usually indicates is some kind of superficial similarity. Right, that these are two things that look like they should be paired, look like they should be together, but are not actually quite the same at their core, right? They look the same, but are of a different sort of essence, right? The second important form of slant rhyme is assonance. And assonance is based on a shared vowel sound. So if you were, say, to rhyme dog with cord, again, they don't actually rhyme, right? The consonant sounds don't match up at all, but the vowel sound is the same. Assonance usually indicates a similarity that is not obvious. Right. You might miss it if you're just looking at the two objects. But when you get down to a close comparison, then yes, there is something there, right? Now, finally, there are words that look like they should rhyme, but when you say them, do not. For example, in the poem, The Passionate Shepherd to His Love by Christopher Marlowe, the first two lines are, come live with me and be my love, and we will all our pleasures prove. So if you just see love and prove on the page, they look like they ought to rhyme, right? But when you speak them, they do not. This is what's called an I-rhyme. Right, something that only looks like a rhyme. And usually all three of these indicate some sort of sleight of hand on the part of the poet, right? A kind of willful misdirection. They're not just sticking words in to find a rhyme. They are usually trying to hint at various kinds of tension in the poem, right? Rhyme is something that is not used arbitrarily just, you know, to help you remember things. It's not used just to make a poem sound pretty. Repeated sounds like rhyme and alliteration are supposed to connect ideas in a poem to each other. So when you see two lines or two words that are rhymed with each other, you are supposed to associate those ideas with each other. So let's look at the first two lines of the second stanza here of the Flea, right? Oh, stay three lives and one flea spare, where we almost, yea, more than married are. What do we notice there? What kind of rhyme is that? Yeah, spare and are don't really rhyme with each other, right? It's an I rhyme. It's almost kind of a half consonants rhyme, right? Because the two words do share that R sound at the end, but the vowel sound is completely different, right? So what does this indicate about the argument that he's trying to make in these two lines, right? He's, oh, stay one, oh, you know, three lives and one flea spare, right? Don't kill the flea and us within it, right? Where we almost, yea, more than married are. What does this suggest about the argument that he's trying to make in these lines? How genuinely similar are the flea that she's about to kill and the marriage that he's using as a, using the flea as a metaphor for?
If she killed the flea, they will be one.
Well, what I'm asking you to look at here is, you know, just the fact that this rhyme is imperfect, right? The rhyme doesn't quite match up. So does the metaphor then, are we supposed to read the metaphor as actually adding up?
It's like a stretch. Just a bit what he's trying to say.
Exactly, yeah. The rhyme indicates that he's stretching his point here, right? It indicates that he's being a little bit tricky, right? He's forcing something to mean something that it really doesn't. The flea is not really like a marriage. It's only like a marriage maybe on a very superficial level, right? The very superficial level that he's talking about here. Right, so these are the kinds of things you can do with rhyme, right? These are the sorts of things you can use rhyme to try to pick out here. Right? Rhyme connects ideas together and often connects them together imperfectly. So you want to look out in particular for instances of these kinds of imperfect rhymes in poems that you read. Because these will often be clues to you to things that are going on in the poem that are not immediately obvious. Right, things are sort of bubbling under the surface. Now, it also helps when you're reading poetry if you know a little bit something about meter and about how sort of the rhythm of a poem is supposed to work, particularly when you're looking at older poetry. A lot of contemporary poets don't really think in these terms quite so much anymore, but it's still a good idea to read a line and to try to point out the bits that are stressed, right? The syllables that are stressed, the parts that you say a little bit louder or more forcefully, are often much more meaningful. These are the parts that the poet means to emphasize, right? So in terms of regular rhythms that you can locate in a poem, there are three basic types of what are, could somebody turn that off, whatever that was? Of what are called metrical feet, right? We call lines of measuring rhythm in poems feet. And feet will typically be either made up of two syllables or three syllables. And they go up or down, right? We consider them rising or falling. So a two-syllable rising foot, we call it I am, right? It's an unstressed syllable followed by a stressed syllable, right? Today would be an I am, right? You say the second syllable more loudly. The inverse of an I am is called a troche, T-R-O-C-H-E-E. And a troche is a stressed syllable followed by an unstressed syllable. So to use the example I keep falling back on, right? Little is a troche. Raven, under. Right. If you say the first syllable more loudly, that's a troche. Now, if we look at three-syllable feet, an anapest is a stressed syllable followed by two unstressed syllables. Underwear. That's an anapest. The opposite, a dactyl, is two unstressed syllables followed by a stressed syllable. And I can't think of an example of that off the top of my head. but the reason we call these rising and falling meters, right, is essentially because of the way they affect the rhythm of the line, right? Iams and anapests go up. They build momentum, they build tension in a line. They build force in a line, right? Iams have this kind of galloping rhythm to them, it's like da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, like a heartbeat. Anapests, if you have a series of them together, sound almost kind of like a military march. Oh, you know what, I've got these reversed. Yes, underwear would be a dactyl, not an anapest. It's less important that you can attach the names to them than that you understand what they do, basically, right? Now, these names all come from Greek, and Greek poets used these different feet to do different things. Right, iams were used for comedy. Dactyls were used for epic, right? Troches, the falling meter, was often used for tragedy, right? So you associated the form with the effect you were trying to get. Now there are two other kinds of what are called special feet. Both two syllable. Right. Spondy is two stressed syllables in succession. Epiric is two unstressed syllables together. Big thing to remember as far as these stresses go, right, is that stressed syllables slow down a line. Unstressed syllables speed it up. You tend to glide over unstressed syllables. You stop on stressed syllables. And so the stressed syllables are usually places of particular emphasis. These are the places where the poet wants your voice to stop, where he or she wants your eye to stop. So a spondee is usually going to be a place of particular emphasis. Right? A pyrrhic is usually going to be kind of virtually meaningless, right? So what I'd like you to do is just take the first line here of the flea. Read it out loud quietly to yourself and see if you can place it into one of these patterns. Just try to mark stressed and unstressed syllables.
Say the first line? Or the first?
Yep, just the first line. See if you can figure out where you think the stresses are. Just let me know when you think you've got something figured out.
My book just says, and mark in this.
You're right. I don't know why I threw the also in there. So let's just take the first half of the line, right, before the comma. Mark but this flea. Which syllables are stressed?
Are we trying to, like, are we picking out one word, or is it, like, the whole line? Are we trying to, like, pick one word and find out which syllables are? I am and Trojio breaking out like a whole.
What, actually, all we're trying to do right now is just look at which syllables are stressed, right? Mm-hmm. Which syllables do you say more forcefully than the others?
Well, I was thinking this flea. Flea. Like,
okay.
This flea.
This flea? What about mark but?
The other way around.
Pardon?
The other way around. Like, but is non-stress.
Are you absolutely sure about that? If you actually say, mark but this flea, do you say any of these words less forcefully than the others? And remember what he's trying to do with this line as well, right? What does he mean by mark but this flea?
Pay attention.
Pay attention, right? Listen up, I've got something I want to show you. So yeah, all four of these syllables are stressed. Because he's trying to get your attention and focus you on this little flea, right? And what about this? And mark in this. And mark in this. and mark in this. Which syllables are stressed, which are unstressed? Okay, this is which? Is it stressed or unstressed? Okay, this is stressed. Is this the only stressed syllable in this part of the line? Mark, okay. Yeah, what were you gonna say, Aaron?
Yeah, that's, I was about to say, I really had that.
So what we have here, right, it's an eight syllable line, two spondees at the beginning. And two iams, right? So the two spondees, right, as he's getting your attention, hey, I'm gonna tell you something now. And the two iams, as he's building his argument, right? His argument is rising. So we would call this a tetrameter line. Because it's made up of 4 feet. Right, so trimeter would be a line of 3 feet. Pentameter ; 5 feet. Hexameter ; 6 feet, and so on and so forth, right? We name the line based on the number of feet, not based on the number of syllables. So if I was to ask you how many syllables are in an iambic pentameter line, how many would that be? That's the number of feet in the line, right? If I'm telling you that the feet are iams, right? Then how many syllables will be in the line? Yeah, exactly. Yeah, so iambic pentameter would have 10 syllables, right? And a pestic pentameter would have 3. Syllables are in an anapest?
3,
right? So anapestic pentameter would have 15 syllables, right? It would be a very long line. Most ancient Greek epics are written in dactylic hexameter. So it's a very long 18-syllable line, right? Typically very long, slow lines. So longer lines tend to be slower, more kind of languid. Shorter lines tend to be faster and more forceful. So by and large, the three poems that you're reading for next time have pretty regular rhythms and rhyme schemes. So I want you to bear all of this in mind as you're reading them, right? And I want you to think about how the rhythm of the poem and the words that are connected by rhyme, right, how that contributes to the emotional tenor of the poem, right? As I said at the beginning of class. Okay, does anybody have any questions? All right, then I'll let you go a few minutes early, right? Go get those papers done, and we'll see you on Thursday.